Thank you so much, Samir. And I have 10 minutes, so I'm going to, could you please put the PowerPoint up? I'm going to use a PowerPoint. And I have 10 minutes, so this is literally a capsule on demographic trends and what do they mean for us. It's something, demographic trends have suddenly become a very important topic, and you hear about how demographic transition is changing the world. And unfortunately, that conversation almost always leads towards overpopulation. And that Malthusian specter of the fact that somehow overpopulation is going to completely stymie the world, it's going to take over, the infrastructure can't survive, the world can't survive, it's this neo-Malthusian specter that has again, for some reason, reared its head in a way that it hadn't, so it was never gone, it was always there. Malthusianism has always been there. But over the last 5 to 10 years, we're seeing a lot more about a kind of a Malthusian sense of overpopulation. So let me give you a capsule that presents some data to you. Obviously, this is not going to be about all demographic trends, and it's not going to be about the implications of all demographic trends, but it is going to tell you about some salient trends that may resonate with you. Some may not resonate with you at all. So let's take a look at the first one. So, okay. So here's the triumvirate of the demographic transition, or here's the triumvirate of demography: fertility, mortality, and migration. Those are the three things that make up a demographic transition. Those are the three things that lead to population change. So what's happening? People are living longer. The mortality transition is very much in evidence. So across the board, life expectancy has risen, child mortality has declined. Across the board, there has been, people just are living longer. Second, they're having fewer kids. And I know that people tend to obsess about fertility. People tend to obsess about fertility one way or another, either low fertility or no fertility or too high fertility. So depending on where you are, people are obsessing about births. And that's probably a good thing in some ways, but not always accurate as far as the data are concerned. Let me give you one aggregate figure, or one aggregate trend. And that aggregate trend is the fact that there has been fertility decline across the board. And pretty much in most regions of the world, fertility is below replacement. What that means is replacement fertility is a fertility of 2.1 children, 2.1 kids per woman that then replace the people who die. So replacement fertility has pretty much has hit or is hitting most regions of the world except sub-Saharan Africa. Sub-Saharan Africa, where fertility decline has commenced in most countries except the fragile countries, still has a fertility of over, in the aggregate, of over 4%. And that's where we probably need to focus, not because of overpopulation, but because that means that there is an unmet need for contraception of women who are unable, if they want to control their fertility, they may be unable to control their fertility, or may actually want more children because they're guarding against some kind of a risk that exists outside their fertility preferences. So as far as Africa is concerned, certainly fertility decline is something that we are concerned about for many, many reasons, as I said. One of them is gender equality, another is reproductive health, a third is maternal health, another is child health. For any number of reasons, we are concerned about fertility decline in Africa. And then there is population movement. And people say that it's the largest population movement in the last 10 years or the last 20 years have seen larger movements of people than they have in the last 50. Depends on how you calculate that. But undoubtedly, migration is something that is going to be with us for many years to come. And that is a really important part of the demographic transition. But let's just realize that the world is a big place. Not only is the world a big place, every region is a big place. Every country is a big place. And so the trends that I'm telling you about are highly heterogeneous. They're heterogeneous by age, by gender, by location, by ethnicity, by sexual orientation, by disability status, by any number of identity markers. These trends actually differ. So, go back to that one. Okay, so let me give you an example of why these trends matter. First, the age structure of the population changes with a demographic transition. The chart you're seeing on the right, the little blue pyramid is actually a population pyramid. It is what a population pyramid used to be, because there are going to be no population pyramids. That's not how the age structure of the population is going to look. It is not going to be a lot of kids in the 0 to 5 age group and very few old people. It has already changed, so the dark blue is something, the change that is occurring, and the line that doesn't have, that's blank, sort of the red line, is what's going to be in 2100. Already, you have many countries in the world, probably most countries in the world, don't have population pyramids anymore. Living arrangements have changed. Increase in nuclear families, increasing in single-person families, and in families that where there's a retreat from child, a retreat from marriage, there's a retreat from childbearing, there's a retreat from the ways in which we knew society to grow are being reordered with this demographic transition. Finally, spatial shifts. Where people live is changing. There used to be a clear urban-rural divide. People used to live mostly in rural areas. They used to engage in agriculture. There used to be a small numbers of people that lived in cities and towns. Cities were small. That has changed. So let's take a look at urbanization and these spatial shifts that I was telling you about. The regions at the bottom that you see, which is basically Latin America and the Caribbean and North America, are almost entirely urban. So when we're talking about an 85% urbanization rate, that's pretty close to universal. So there are very few people that are living in rural areas. In Japan, 93% of the population lives in cities and towns. So in most, in the bottom three regions, you see urbanization as having actually happened. The places where urbanization is happening is Asia. In certain countries in Asia where it's still happening, whereas in others it looks very much like Latin America, but Africa. And that's where we really need to focus, because Africa, because it started a little late, is the fastest urbanizing continent in the world. So the rate of urbanization in Africa is faster than the rate of urbanization anywhere else, precisely because it started from a lower base. And then let's look at aging. So I told you people are just living longer. And this is something we don't necessarily think about. When we're in Africa, when we're in India, when we're in Bangladesh, when we're in Pakistan, we don't really think about aging. But in fact, if you take a look at aging, you find that large proportions of the population are 65 plus in the regions of the world that are basically Latin America and the Caribbean, Asia, Australia, North America. And this proportion is growing as people are going to get older or live longer and have fewer kids. Aging is something that's going to happen to us all, but it's going to happen to certain regions faster than others. Africa is still a very young continent. This is something I wanted to share with you. Aging has gender implications. And why is this important? It's important because women tend to live longer than men, and that's a biological fact. Women tend to live longer than men, and so in the oldest age groups, you find just a lot more women than there are men. And they tend to be living alone. In the countries that are aging, so for instance in Japan, the proportion of women that live alone is much greater than the proportion of men that live alone. And also, it has gender implications because the people who care for the elderly are also women. So it's a highly gendered development. But Africa will stay young. So if you take a look at the graph on the left, essentially it's telling you what's going to happen to Africa in terms of young people by 2020. So it's going to be, there's going to be a huge increase. There's about a 50% increase in the youth population in Africa. And this is something I'm bringing up. The second graph is something I'm bringing up because I mentioned it yesterday, which is on conflict. People displaced by conflict are predominantly in Middle East and North Africa and in sub-Saharan Africa, not in Europe, not in other parts of the world. The increase is also in Africa. I'm not going to go through this because I'm probably going over, but basically that demographic changes are not just demographic changes. They are highly political changes. And so there are various surveys that ask people, so how many people do you think are refugees in your country? And they vastly overestimate it. And here, this is a chart that basically says that a large proportion of people that have refugees, a large proportion of people in the countries that have refugees tend to think that refugees are terrorists. And then finally, what do we do about it? We have a really simple tool. We have four questions that you ask, and you can actually download this freely. If you just type in social inclusion assessment tool, there's a four-question methodology that allows us to think about who, why, how, and what can we do about it. Thank you.